Welcome to Take Good Care Podcast,
an endeavor that grew out of our love for obstetrics and gynecology. Our aim and mission is to serve as a source of vital information for women of all races, ages, and walks in life.
I am Dr. Miranda Williams.
I am Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I am Dr. Karen Greene.
Welcome to our show. Welcome to this episode of Take Good Care Podcast. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I'm Dr. Karen Greene.
We're back with you to give a quick acknowledgement and homage to the topic of women and heart disease. We recently attended a luncheon, a women's heart health luncheon that has been sponsored for many years by the Morehouse School of Medicine. It started in the year 2009 by, at that time, the First Lady of Morehouse School of Medicine, Mrs. Eileen Maupin. And what this luncheon has been started and continues to support is raising student scholarship funds for the Masters of Public Health students now, the medical students, and the physician assistant students who matriculate through Morehouse School of Medicine so that they can go out into our communities and promote healthy lifestyles and increase community awareness as it relates to heart health and cardiovascular disease. So for today's episode, we want to talk and share stories of women that we know or women that we've heard about to hopefully encourage and inspire you to encourage the women in your lives to see about themselves as it relates to their heart health. So welcome to this episode of Take Good Care Podcast. I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I'm Dr. Karen Greene.
So I am a proud graduate of Morehouse School of Medicine. It is where I attended for medical school training before going off to residency. And so my partners and myself over the years have tried to really support efforts related to Morehouse School of Medicine and any other health institutions in the area that help to support students and residents and those in training. We frequently would have people come and shadow us in the office as well, because we believe in having a legacy that when we're retired and no longer taking care of patients, that there's a wealth of new and young and inspiring talent that can come and continue with that. So again, we attended recently the Women's Heart Health Luncheon that Morehouse School of Medicine promotes. As you may know, February is Heart Health Month, and there usually, I think it's the first Friday of February, is the Wear Red for Women, you wear red or red dresses for women and heart disease and how important that is. And so we all have either been affected personally by women in our lives who have either been challenged because of heart health or actually even lost their health or lost their lives because of heart disease. So we wanted to, instead of just talking about the facts and the figures and the science, because we've done that, and you can feel free to please check out some of our earlier episodes where we did talk about specifically heart health and what's important and how to take care of your heart health. But today we just want to share some stories.
Dr. Guthrie or Dr. Greene? So my story is with my best friend from my high school years. She was the first person that, when we moved here to Georgia when I was 12 and we started attending a church, she was the first person that just walked up to me and just started speaking to me. Now, we didn't end up going to the same school, but she was my best friend all through high school. We talked every day on the phone, you know, hung out on the weekends. And it started where she had a very, very, very significant family history of heart disease, cardiovascular disease. As it turned out, her mother passed away at age 42 from an aneurysm.
You're all of similar ages.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm. So we're like 2 months apart. But her mother, when I just started my residency, passed away from an aneurysm. Mm. So she lost her mom very early. And then her father passed away from a heart attack, several years later. From the time she was in her, I would say, early to mid-20s, she was already on blood pressure medication for high blood pressure. Mm. And you know, when you're young, again, high blood pressure being that silent killer, because mm-hmm. you don't feel anything. Mm-hmm. You could be able, you know, you could be somebody who runs or exercises. You mm-hmm. could be somebody who thinks you're eating healthy. Mm-hmm. But sometimes it's just genetics. You can do everything that you can, but it's just genetics. And for her, it definitely was. So starting in her mid to early 20s, she was first on one blood pressure medication, then two, then three, and very, very difficult to control. But she, you know, and I give her credit, you know, she tried her best. She did, you know, she regularly went to the doctor. She regularly took her medication. And I would always, you know, get on her about that. Well, the story that I want to tell is that now here it is. She was 51, I think it was. And one day I came to the office. I was seeing patients and I saw that I missed a call from her. And as we got older, you know, we weren't talking every day, but, you know, we would speak regularly. But she called me. I saw that there was a missed call, and usually she would call me to give me news of people that we knew, you know, growing up. Somebody got married, somebody had a baby, somebody passed away. Mm-hmm. And so I was just thinking, oh, she's just calling to tell me something. I'll just check in with her, like, on the ride home or whatever. Well, I ended up calling her back because I had a little break in patience. And she goes, oh, she goes, I didn't mean to call you. That was a butt dial. I just, you know, I ended up falling and, you know, and she was even kind of laughing. And she goes, yeah, so I wasn't really trying to call you. I was trying to call somebody else. And so I said, you fell. I said, well, what happened? You know, think it's going to be a funny story. And she goes, well, I know I was just kind of moving around in the house. And then I fell over and I felt kind of dizzy. And then she said to me, but my sister's here right now. And so, you know, I think I'm okay. And I'm like, well, why would you call your sister? That's not just a funny, I tripped over a chair. So I said, well, put your sister on the phone, you know. And I said, so, you know, her sister's name, we called her Mimi. I said, Mimi, what's going on? She goes, well, she's kind of speaking kind of funny, you know, and she kind of fell and we don't know if she was out for a while. And I said, take her immediately to the emergency room, you know. I said, take her there now. And so they ended up going to the emergency room and her blood pressure was like 200 and something over 126 or something like that.
And tell the audience what's a normal blood pressure.
Well, normal blood pressure should be, you know, 120s. It could be in the 110s, depending on your size, to 60s, 70s, 80s are okay. So that's not what she was, 220 something over 120 something. Mm-hmm. And as it ended up, as she got to the emergency room, she ended up having a stroke in the emergency room. And then from that point on, her health just deteriorated just rapidly. She was a premature baby. She ended up finding out, again, high blood pressure affects your kidneys. And so she didn't realize this, but as a preemie baby, she had decreased function in one of her kidneys. So she was already at a disadvantage, but never had any symptoms yet of it. Mm-hmm. And then everything just went haywire. She ended up on dialysis. And just from that point on, her life was just never the same. Mm-hmm. But this is somebody, like I said, who was trying to do her best, mm-hmm. you know, but, you know, it is a very serious matter. Don't take symptoms for granted. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not something that, I'll just check it out next week or my next doctor's appointment 3 months from now. Mm-hmm. You really don't want to do that. Mm-hmm. And she ended up passing away 3 years ago now. It's going to be 3 years, and I think in September. But just from that point on, her health, she ended up on dialysis because of loss of kidney function. But no, you know, cardiovascular disease is very serious disease. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
You have anything, Karen?
I think that when we went to the Heart Health Luncheon, we hadn't been since 2020. And that was actually the first time I had gone. And the thing that stuck out to me at that luncheon was the stories. Mm-hmm. And the stories 3 years ago, they're still in my mind. And so we heard more stories this particular year about women who I guess we can relate to because they're just like us mm-hmm. in terms of they have families, they have jobs, they have responsibilities. And as women, we tend to always do those things first and take care of ourselves later. Mm-hmm. And, you know, which doesn't really bode well for heart disease because a lot of times for women especially, the symptoms aren't as clear cut. Mm-hmm. And, you know, you often think, well, it's just indigestion. You know, or it's something else, and you kind of put it off and don't do anything about it. And so the story I heard that comes to mind recently, and honestly, I was trying to think just yesterday, was this something that I heard at the Heart Health or was this something that I heard in church? Because, again, it was a woman telling a story about, mm-hmm. you know, that she had, this chest pain. And so she goes to the doctor. They try to figure out what's going on. You know, they can't find anything, you know, so she goes home. You know, so, or she goes again, they can't figure anything what's going on. They hospitalize her for a couple of days. They still can't figure out what's going on, so she comes home. And then so finally, she goes to see somebody else, and they figure out that, you know, what is going on and send her directly to the cardiologist. Mm-hmm. And so the cardiologist says, you know, you want the good news or the bad news? He's like, well, the good news is we caught it. Bad news is I need to admit you. She's like, well, I've got a trip planned. You know, can I wait? She's like, no, you can't wait. You need to have this done now. Mm-hmm. You know, and when you hear the story, you think, yeah, I can see myself saying the same thing. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's things of, you know, I had a 90% blockage of, you know, one of my major arteries to my heart that they're now catching. And because they're catching it sooner, you know, that if I had gone on that trip, I might not have made the trip or, you know, the last trip, last trip I ever had. Mm-hmm. Because it is those things that you know something's wrong and you go to the doctor, but then you think, well, I'm still feeling pretty good, even though I think something's wrong. And even though the doctor says, you know, we need to do A, B, and C, you need to have open heart surgery, but I had a trip planned. Mm-hmm. And so our thought process isn't always, you know, take care of yourself. And I think that the thing that the stories kind of always bring back to home to me is if you think something is wrong, if you're feeling something is wrong, or if you have a friend and they're telling you a story and you're like, that doesn't sound right, you probably should be seen by the doctor. That instinct is the right instinct. Mm-hmm. You know, go and get yourself checked out. Mm-hmm. You know, go and take care of yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, go and see what's going on. And so I guess that's what always has affected me in terms of just, you know, this particular month, you start to realize again, you know, take care of yourself.
Mm-hmm. You'll never regret finding out everything is okay.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. But you'll regret not finding out that something was wrong. Right. You know,
right.
So.
Right. And so with this luncheon, every year, as Dr. Greene has said, they usually have some testimonials by women who have these just incredible mm-hmm. stories of survival, thank God, of their situation. And a recurring theme is usually one where they just felt something wasn't quite right. And this one woman told about, you know, as Dr. Greene mentioned, going to be seen, you know, going to the emergency room or going to urgent care. Nothing could be determined. You know, they would send her home, but she just kept saying, something doesn't feel right. Something doesn't feel right. So she persisted. And I think there's been, you know, this meme or something out circulating over the last few years that says, nevertheless, she persisted. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, the lesson of that story and stories like that is you have to advocate for yourself. And if you feel like something is not right, until you get an answer that feels comfortable to you, persist. And if that healthcare provider doesn't seem to be getting you the answers or giving you a level of comfort or even evaluating it to see if there's something going on, then you have to go and find someone who's going to listen. You have to persist. So in that woman's story, her persistence saved her life. You know, it literally saved her life because when she started having a heart attack and having some things happen in the healthcare facility, they were able to address it because she persisted and she happened to be somewhere that it could be handled acutely. And it saved her life. Another category of stories is for the woman, like most of us, who's busy. I got a lot going on. I don't have time to be sick. Mm-hmm. So we talk ourselves out of going to be seen. This one particular woman, I forget what it was, her symptom, it was some vague symptom. It wasn't anything major like the classic, you know, chest pain, arm numbness, whatever. And she went to be seen after someone like browbeat her to the urgent care. And they then told her, well, you need to go to the next step. And she says, okay, but she didn't do it. And so that happened two or three times. Then she did go in to be seen, but she's having these vague, funny symptoms. So it wasn't really completely followed up on. And so she kind of was in that little merry-go-round until she finally got to the right provider who did the right test. And as she put it, she discovered that stress broke her heart. Literally broke her heart. She had ruptured her aortic valve. Yeah. Like, it had just ruptured. So when she finally had the correct test done, and that cardiologist is like, were you born with this hole in your heart? She's like, what are you talking about? They're like, you're going to the operating room now. And she had to have a valve replacement. But she's a busy professional, slim, I mean, woman, active, doing all the right things. But when she started having this little vague something, you know, instead of following up in a timely fashion, she didn't do it. Thank God she finally listened, got to the right person. And again, it saved her life. But I think the one of the things that they do every year, and even though they do it every year, it still is impactful, is that they'll generally have, you know, three women who are giving their story, telling their testimony. And then there's an empty chair that is also on the stage. And what that empty chair represents is a woman who may have been with us at the previous luncheon or wherever we last encountered this woman. But now she's not here. There's an empty chair because that woman has lost her life due to heart disease, which, as we discussed in one of our previous episodes, is the leading cause of death for women. We have women that come in all the time that are concerned about, God bless their hearts, all kind of esoteric rare things because they heard something on the internet or they saw something on TikTok or they went to Dr. Google. And because they have this pain in their pelvic area, and I had this one person who didn't even have a uterus. She had a hysterectomy, but and everything was out. Uterus, tubes, and ovaries, but she had this pelvic pain. So she just knew she had cancer in her female organs that she no longer had. But because it was something she saw on Google, I said, well, it's more likely that it's gastrointestinal, you know, because common things are common. But we go looking for rare things when it's not the rare things that's going to get us. Yeah. It's the common things that are going to get
heart
us.
Disease.
Cardiovascular disease is still the leading cause of death for women across the board. For Black and brown women, the numbers are even higher. I lost my mother almost 4 years ago now, essentially due to heart disease. She was overweight, hypertensive, a nurse, we're the worst patients, a registered nurse, did not take her medications as consistently as she should have initially, didn't really take care of herself as much as she should have initially. Why? Because she was too busy taking care of everybody else. Me, my dad, the neighborhood kids, her mom, her sister, her friends, her coworkers, their children. You know, that's just what mama did. Until she started having this numbness and tingling that went away, unfortunately, until the next day or two when it didn't go away and she had a stroke. And it was a massive stroke. And so I remember asking God not to take my mom. So at that time, thankfully, it was a wake-up call for all of us. And so mama did take care of herself better. Me and daddy took care of her, my daddy in particular. So thank God mama did stay with us for 20 more years after having a massive stroke. So the other thing that I always like to bring out when we talk about these stories is that death, yes, is horrible and final. But the other piece of cardiovascular disease is when you don't die, but you have to live impaired. Mm. When your life and your quality of life may be affected because you can't move, you're partially paralyzed, you can't speak or communicate as clearly as you did before because of the consequences of cardiovascular disease, stroke, kidney failure, those things that all respond or a consequence of blood pressure that hasn't been controlled. So we share these stories and we bring these to your attention. Yes, during the month of February, but it may be any month that you're watching this podcast or listening to this podcast. And if we do nothing else with our platform, than to encourage women and those who love women. To everybody loves women. You love your mama, you love your sister, you love somebody, your auntie, your friend. To take care of themselves. Listen to your body. Listen to your intuition. It's there for a reason. And if something ain't right, persist until you get the answer that gives you peace. And if someone tells you go to the doctor, go to the doctor. If someone says go to the emergency room, mm-hmm. go to the emergency room and take your medicine. Mm. As my cardiologist who took care of my mother tells me every day, because I got genetic issues. You know, I'm doing everything I need to do, but my mama is my mama, my dad is my daddy. I have genetic issues. So as Dr. Douglas tells me, take my medicine. I'm going to take his medicine. And to the point of taking care of yourself, taking care of yourself doesn't mean going when something is wrong. It means going on a regular basis. Get your regular checkups. Get your regular examinations. I was recently seen by my cardiologist just because it was a routine checkup. I feel fine. I've been doing better, eating better, exercising. Well, my blood pressure was up. I feel great. I felt the best I have in a long time. So I'm like, well, what do you mean my blood pressure's up? Because I'm taking the medication, mm-hmm. I'm eating, I'm drinking my water, my exercise consistency has fallen off, but I'm getting back on track with that. That's the problem with hypertension.
Yeah.
By the time you feel bad, it's not good.
It's not good. Mm-hmm.
Go get your regular checkups with your primary care physicians, your internal medicine physicians, your gynecologists, because that's part of our job, is to do your vital signs, check all the things, so that if something needs to be evaluated, we can get you to the right place.
Yeah. Ladies. When I was diagnosed with high blood pressure, I was probably in my 40s. Mm-hmm. So 15, 16 years ago. And I was already on a medicine to control an irregular heart rate. And I saw the cardiologist for that. And so every time I went to see him, I would say, well, I'm post-call. That's why my blood pressure's up.
Now, it could be because it was, you know, I was post-call and I was half asleep. And so instead of taking the medicine for my heart when I needed it, he said, well, start taking it every day. I was like, oh, okay, if I must. And so I took it every day. And a couple of years went by. And then one day I just didn't feel well. And so I was in the office. And other than the cardiologist, as a physician, I didn't see anybody else. I saw the gynecologist sitting right next to me. And so the nurse practitioner took my blood pressure, and it was 180 over 100. And she looked at me, Dr. Greene, what's wrong with you? I said, I don't know. I don't feel right, you know. And so luckily I was able to go see, you know, my primary doctor, who I don't see very often. And she put me on another medication.
And so for several years, I was on two medications. And, you know, in my mind, I was like, I can't be on these two medications. I've got to change some things. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, it really does kind of come down to, I was not aware that I had high blood pressure. Being adopted, I didn't really have much family history. And so I went and got more family history, only to find out my birth mother was on four blood pressure medicines in her 40s. Wow. So I was like, well, okay. Genes. And knowing the genes for me was like, okay, I have to take this even though I feel well. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not something that's post-call related or stress related. It's probably genetic, you know. And then my birth father, same situation, you know, lots of high blood pressure medications. So for me, you know, I needed the science behind it. Like, okay, that's the reason. You know, I might not look like I have high blood pressure, but I do.
And you've always been active. You've always worked out.
I've done all the right things, you know. And so, and because I also know the consequences in the long term, you know, things that can happen, for me, that's like, okay, I need to take my medications. You know, I need to do the right thing. And so when I go to, you know, I finally got off the two medications and I'm now taking one. But when I went to the cardiologist just recently, same cardiologist, love Dr. Douglas.
Shout out Dr. Douglas.
You know, he looks at my labs and he's like, well, you know, your cholesterol is up. I said, I know. I said, okay. And because I know the relationship between cholesterol and heart disease and heart attacks, that I could feel fine and still have a heart attack, that I'm going to make the best effort. And if I can't do it, if I can't change my diet enough because genetically it's just going to be me because my cholesterol has been borderline forever, then I'm just going to take the medication. You know, no matter how I feel, I'm just going to take the medication. So, because I even asked him one year, can I get off this medication? He said, no. I was like, well, okay. If you say so, I guess, you know, it is what it is, you know, but I want to be here. I want to be here for my kids. And so I want to take care of myself just like I take care of my patients. You know, I tell them, you need to go to the doctor because your blood pressure's up. You need to take your medicine because your cholesterol's up. So I need to follow my own advice.
So we share our stories, our own, as well as our loved, you know, friends and family, some who are with us and some, unfortunately, who have gone on, to encourage those who may be listening to take good care. Take care of yourself and take care of your friends and family. And if you are so inclined and you would like to support student scholarships, specifically at the Morehouse School of Medicine, you can text to give. You can text HEART, H-E-A-R-T 23 to 41444. Again, you can text to give at HEART, H-E-A-R-T 23 to 41444. As a proud graduate of Morehouse School of Medicine, and I was the beneficiary of several scholarship support when I was there, I believe your money will be well invested in the health of our communities to continue to provide healthcare providers that can give the good information that is culturally sensitive to all people. So that everyone can be taken good care of. If you have any questions or if you have any comments, if there's anything that we can cover that you would like to hear us talk about, please send us an email to docs.ptcobgyn@gmail.com. Again, that's email address, docs.ptcobgyn@gmail.com. Our website is changing and being updated, so continue to check it out. We think you're going to find some exciting information there at ptcobgyn.com. Continue to share us with your friends and family, wherever you get your podcasts. And until we sign on again, I'm Dr. Miranda Williams.
I'm Dr. Deanna Guthrie.
And I'm Dr. Karen Greene. Take good care.